Hi, I'm Ed Bacon, the rector of All Saints Church, Pasadena. Whoever you are and wherever you find yourself on the journey of faith, I hope that you'll find something here that speaks to you. Welcome.
You all know the proverbial alien landing and wanting to see the best of the human race. You know that story? Well, okay. You're not saying, yeah, Ed, yeah. Okay, so aliens could land at any moment on our front yard. And what they would most likely want is for us to put forward the best that the human race has to offer. Because they want to know what is a real human being, right? So if the proverbial alien landed and wanted to know what was the best the human race had to offer, I would put forward our speaker this morning. Now, I wouldn't be doing it just because she is a very, very, very smart person. Absolutely beautifully educated, including a law degree from Harvard. Is absolutely what we sexists call drop-dead gorgeous, and has a silver tongue. That's not why I would put her forward. The reason I would put Connie Rice forward is because she is fearless, fierce, and a fruitful advocate for justice. In this town, she has turned things around in terms of violence in some of the most violent, plagued urban communities. She has been the person responsible for the humanity quotient of the Los Angeles police force absolutely spiking. She's not been afraid to bring in the wisdom of the best of the military, and she's not afraid to speak truth to power, and she's got an outstanding book called Power Concedes Nothing, One Woman's Quest for Social Justice, which all of you need to read. I am thrilled that on this day in which our president has just been through his second inauguration legally, and tomorrow we'll do it ceremonially, on Martin Luther King Day, that we have somebody whose compendium of Martin Luther King speeches is more dog-eared than mine. Will you please warmly welcome Connie Rice?
This is witty. He knows me better than I think he does. And I love Ed Bacon. I just think, you know, I'm going to put this out here because I love this community, and I am not a model for anything. In fact, people run from the room screaming when they really realize what I'm about. But I am good for getting change, Spark. Ed's right about that. But Reverend Bacon, I have to say, I am drawn. I am someone who has basically lived out and carried out a Christian prophet's vision. So every day of my life, I am hewing to a Christian vision, the true Christian vision of love and inclusion and making sure that every human being gets what she needs to be, what she's supposed to be. At bottom, that's what Christ was about, and I have always loved Christ. But I can't claim to be a Christian. I can't claim to be anything. And the older I get, the more agnostic I get. I'm truly agnostic. So it is strange, it is so strange to be so tied to Christianity, to people like Ed Bacon and Bishop Blake. And I can't tell you the number of churches who have been my clients. And so I'm strange anyhow, but I am really strange when it comes to asking questions about, well, what do you base your philosophy on? I do base it in Christianity. Christ, the greatest prophet of all time, and I mean from Buddha compared to Muhammad, Christ has it down. He won that contest. And when you don't have to believe that he is the Son of God or anything else that has to do with true Christianity. I can't claim to be a Christian. But do I think that he is one of the most fantastic human beings that ever graces this earth, and he's still with us, and he's still controlling lives like mine? The answer is yes. So you don't have to be a believer to be of a religious community. And you don't have to be a believer to live every day of your life following Christian prophets, which is what I do. When I did the MTA case, it was because Martin Luther King Jr. said on page 347 in this book, and it's a pink thing. You can tell I'm disorganized and I'm getting worse as I get older. For those of you in your 40s, enjoy your 40s. The 50s are horrible. I don't even want to see the 60s. Okay, I'm almost 60 and I'm just dying to know what's going to happen to me in the 60s. Because the 50s were something. And for women, it's just traumatic. But I don't know how I'm standing here, but the things you lose in your 50s are amazing. Amazing. But I'm still standing, and I'm still fighting, and I made it through my 50s, so let's see what the 60s bring. And I can't wait to be 80, because I'm going to be a hellion of an old woman. I'm bad enough now and act like an old woman, ordering people around and acting like I own everything. And I've channeled Queen Elizabeth I a little too closely, but she was one of my first sheroes after my mother was QE1, I call her. And I do have those tendencies. Believe me, you can ask Chief Beck and Chief Bratton about my royalist tendencies. And when I get angry, they really come out. It's kind of strange to see me when I'm angry. I think that's what shocks people when I'm angry, but I'll get to that in a minute. Anyway, the MTA case. I would drive by people at the bus stops, and there was no shelter over their heads. They were standing out in the sun, and I was like, what's the matter with this place? What, can't they build shelters? And I would just keep driving. You know, I had things to do. I had cases to do. I didn't pay any attention to these people. And I didn't really think about what it took for someone who earned $11,000 a year and was trying to raise two children on her own. What did it take to get around this county? I really didn't think about it. I just drove my little, well, at the time it was a Honda Civic. It looked like a beat-up soup can. Now I've graduated and I have a blue Prius. That gets me in trouble for different reasons, but I had the Columbo theory of cars. You just let it get more and more banged up so that when it finally gets stolen out of the lot at work, which it would get stolen, it would be worth more than having it. So I would just let it get dinged, and I mean, it was a Columbo car. I took my theory of car ownership from Columbo, the detective, the TV detective, and I'd wheel it around, and I was always down in Watts because it wasn't a year that I was in L.A. that I realized that 7 miles south of me, and this was something of a shock, here I am, the civil rights lawyer, the supposed civil rights lawyer, and I didn't know that there were areas in my backyard where children couldn't walk to school safely, that there was a gang war raging, and that they had to go to sleep in the bathtub because the bullets would come through the wall, and that two of the children I met had lost a sibling. The baby got shot in the crib because the bullets came through the wall, and they were fighting over drug turf for the crack war. And so crack, I didn't understand that in my own backyard, children couldn't walk to school. Mail deliverers couldn't deliver the mail for 2 weeks at a time because the gangs were warring. I didn't understand what the gangs were. I didn't know any gangsters. Who knows gangsters? I mean, I come from Harvard. How am I going to know gangsters? And I've got this law degree, and I'm supposed to be, you know, arguing in courts with marble court, you know, stands and paneled walls with solid redwood and oak on the walls. I mean, I'm supposed to be privileged. I'm saying I'm from Harvard. You know, I'm not supposed to be down groveling with gangsters. What's the matter with these people? Don't they understand what civil rights is about? So Miss Thang here had to learn that it's not about your cases. I realized we were winning our cases and our clients were losing their lives. What did it mean? I had a stellar career and was on my way to making my first Supreme Court argument. And then I woke up and I realized that going to the Supreme Court was actually malpractice. And when I told my boss, Norman Chachkin, that he was in New York and couldn't find L.A. on a map, I told my boss that I was scuttling, my case was on its way up to the United States Supreme Court, and that's, you know, that's the sine qua non for lawyers. You go to the United States Supreme Court, and you flounce around, and you may please the court, and da-da-da. And my boss was telling me, Connie, you cannot say, it will not please the court, so you have to be there. You have to tell them you're happy to be there. Because I don't really want to lie under oath and do what Ickes did when he said, I'm not pleased to be here, because I'm under oath, I cannot tell you I'm pleased to be here or that I will do what you want me to do, because I'm not, and I'm not happy to be here, and I don't like you, and I'm going to tell the truth. And my boss said, no, you cannot do that at the United States Supreme Court, because he knows me, and he knows that I would do something like that. And this was before Clarence Thomas was on the court. So... Anita Hill's a friend of mine, so I don't know what I would say if I ever got before this United States. It would be scandalous. Do you hear me? It would be a scandal. Oprah would have me on her show after that performance. I'd be on OWN Network, and I was on her show twice before. But anyway, I am a child of privilege. I am the great-granddaughter of slaves and slave owners. I am 19th century America blended. I have Cherokee ancestors and Seminole. Those are the two Native American tribes that we're aware of, and there's some others we don't even know. We believe we have the blood of a tribe that got wiped out with the smallpox in our genocidal drive to own this country. So I am part Native American. And I have Irish ancestors, which is why I sometimes dye my hair red. And I have Anglo-Saxon ancestors. Condi likes those ancestors best of all. She likes this admiral that we descended from. I don't know how he got in the wood pile. But somehow a British admiral got into the wood pile. Who knows? The Rice women are beautiful, but, you know, you never know who got into the wood pile in our family. So we claim a British admiral, so we have Anglo-Saxon, we have Celt, a lot of Celt, Irish and Scottish. So I am an Afro-Indo-Celt. I mean, it's enough to make the Ku Klux Klan lunge for their hoods, right? And believe me, I have actually represented a Klansman, which was part of my story in my book, you know, I represented a Klansman because I thought it was immoral when I told the NAACP legal defense. So I said, it's immoral to represent only African Americans, because if we only represent African American death row inmates, we will accelerate the death dates of the white men. You cannot do that. So if we represent the African Americans, we have to represent the white men. They said, good, you represent the white people. So I got to represent the white men, and half of them were Klansmen. If you could have seen those interactions. It took everything I had to remain professional. This one man, John Rook, serial killer. I had to learn that there are some clients you can't meet with face-to-face because women like me are the people they kill. And learning how to deal with a serial killer who was just beyond pathological. But this guy, but I also understood that he had been raised in a foster care system that had prostituted him out, because they actually had the foster care system they had these predatory pedophiles who ran the foster care system, and so they sold the children for sex. And before that, his father would make him sleep in a dumpster where the rats ate him at night to punish him because he didn't do something exactly, and he would beat the children with farm implements. So they had five boys, and four of them were in prison, two were on death row. This was a, you heard about this family on 60 Minutes because it was the house where they had a foot of feces on the floor. You remember that show. I'm sure some of you remember. That was the house, and I had the child of that abusive, beyond abusive house. It doesn't excuse what he did. He became a pathological serial killer, and I couldn't sympathize with that. But I understood why he was. How do you make a serial killer? Well, this is one way to do it. How do you take a child and turn him into a predatory killing machine? I understood that. I was terrified of him, and I wouldn't meet with him face to face. He was one of the clients I'd met with between the plexiglass. I don't think he'd been touched by a human being in 10 years. And I didn't really have a whole lot of sympathy for him because he had murdered 7 women that we knew of. And he kills people like me. Serial killers love women like me. We live by ourselves. We're strange and we're easy. We're the low-hanging fruit. I am the low-hanging fruit. I get it. You know, women aren't supposed to live alone, but I'll give another lecture on that. I love living alone. I'm a total loner. I met with him, and the first time he met with me, he called me it rhymes with trucking. Yellow rhymes with runt. It was such a creative and nasty racist epithet that I wrote it down. I said, oh, wait. Call me that again, because I've never been called anything like that. I wrote it down. They cut it out of my book because it was a little too colorful. But I understood him. I understood from where he came. It was poor white poverty in backwoods of North Carolina. And he had been abused by predatory parents and then by a predatory foster care system. I wasn't excusing anything he did. He needed to be in prison. He was right where he needed to be. But I didn't think we needed to fry him alive. I just don't believe in frying other human beings alive. And I don't believe in killing people. I just don't. I don't care what they've done. And our system of killing people, as Sister Prejean will tell you, hey, Iran doesn't do much worse than we do. I know 7 innocent people, and we just executed someone innocent in this country. And I know too many people who have confessed falsely. I know what the police are capable of because I've sued them my whole life. I know cops better than I know myself. So when I represented him, it was a moral imperative. It's something that this congregation would understand. It's why I feel at home here. You have the same moral framework in your head. Don't have to excuse and don't have to accept, but we do know what we have to defend. We have to defend the moral goodness of the universe, and we have to defend people so that the statement can be made that you are never alone. Even when you are terrible, there is someone who will defend you because the system requires it, and our moral construct requires it. I wasn't defending him. I was defending our morality, is how I look at it. And you have to defend the most heinous criminals, otherwise your justice system can't stand. I got that. I got that even as a kid lawyer. And when I dealt with John, the first thing I said to him was, I said, you can cuss me out and call me. I said, I like that. I like that. That's very colorful. I wrote down everything he called me. He cussed me out for a good minute and a half. I mean, it was pretty amazing. He was very angry with me, and I was the one human being he could take it out on. And I said, look, I'm a law student, and I'm the only thing standing between you and that yellow electric chair down the hall. So I can leave, or we can fight to save your life. You going to help me or not? He shut up and he started. I said, here's what I need. I need you to tell me what happened. I need you to give me the facts again. And then I need you to tell me what's happened to you since you've been in prison. And I went back and I wrote a fantastic petition. I'm a very, very good lawyer. And as a law student, I did my best work. I tell the law students I talk to, I did my best work as a student, and my career has been downhill ever since. Amazingly creative. I said, you know what? We need a theory of equitable estoppel here. I need to tell the state of North Carolina, you don't get to execute this man because you created him. You abuse a child in your state foster care system. You created this predator. Your hands have blood on them, and you do not get to throw the switch in this case. You created this monster, and you protected him, not his victims, and then you abused him again. And so you are stopped. You no longer have the moral right to execute him. Great argument, don't you think? And something that Christ would argue, right? It's a moral argument. It wasn't basic. I found a legal hook for it, but it's a moral argument. You abused this child, and you how to create a serial killer. Just look at North Carolina. Look what they did with John Rook. That's how you create a serial. How do you create a sexual predator? Ah, sexually abuse the child, throw him in a bin with rats at night, have a father who beats him with tractor implements, and then sexually abuse him in a prostitution ring with your father. How do you in the world do you put your foster care system into the hands of pedophiles? I ask you. And now you want to kill him? I'm sorry. You don't get to do that. Do you know? It got him a hearing. North Carolina, that in state court? That's amazing. A hearing? LDF was throwing me a party. I got them to stop for a minute. They had the hearing, and I looked at that court, and I said, oh, my goodness, Attila the Hun had better justices than these people. It was amazing we got the hearing, that they even read my brief, because they don't usually read the briefs. They just say, go ahead with the execution. They don't read the arguments. But it got the attention of the clerks, and the clerks said, well, wait a minute, you better read this. And so they gave us a hearing, which was a huge win. Of course, we lost. But it did get a hearing. And we argued for an hour and a half. I couldn't argue because as much as my delusion made me think I was the attorney of record, I was still a law student. It's actually illegal for law students to represent people. But I thought I was a lawyer, and I actually got up to make the argument, and Steve Winter had to sit me down, and he's like, Connie, you're not a lawyer yet. And I'm like, well, I did the pay. Shh. Shh. The delusion is part of my strength. I'm completely delusional, and that's what allows me to do a lot of what I do. But anyway, more on that later. I sat there and watched that argument, and those judges actually listened. They ruled. We actually got five judges to vote for our position. And you have to understand, in North Carolina, that's like going to Saddam Hussein's court and getting votes. And they agreed with our argument that the state had dirty hands and should not kill this heinous murderer because they had created him. They co-created him. John Rook went to the electric chair a year later. I was in my third year by then. I was finishing law school, and I was worried about another inmate on death row, Billy Neal Moore, whom we did get off. We got him off. We got the matriarch of the family of the victim to say that she wanted him freed. And the reason Billy Neal Moore is free to this day, and he now lectures as a pastor. He's a pastor to death rows across the country now. And he is one of the most religiously compelling people I've ever met. He's the most Christ-like person I've ever met. And I'm not swayed by inmates because they're all con men. They have to be. They have to win you to make you stick with them, to help them fight for their lives. And so when they all, you know, everybody converts to Christianity or Buddhism or something on death row, death has a way of making you quite religious. And I never found any of it very compelling until I met Billy Moore. And when he walked into the room, the guards almost knelt to kiss his hand. I had, for the first time, death row guards write me a letter to say that they could not help to kill Billy Moore and that they would lose their jobs, but that they would submit a letter on his behalf. So in his petition, we had letters from the guards and the Georgia Diagnostic Center, and we had pastors from all over the South testifying to how Christ-like this man was. The whole of death row would wait for him to give a sermon. And he was ready to die. He admitted his crime. Billy Neal Moore is probably the most important client I've ever had. And we went to visit the sister of the man he murdered. And we said, we want to save his life. And she was a deeply, deeply religious woman, lived on a farm outside of Atlanta on Julia Boaz, my sidekick, whom I write about in my book. You got to read my book. It's a wonderful book. I've had people tell me that they took off work from 2 days because they couldn't put my book down. It's really, really good. And I tell the story of Julia and me. They cut my story by 3/4. I mean, I wrote about 150 pages just on our adventures, and, you know, there's about 30 in the book. But anyway, Julia and I were these sidekicks. She was from Yale. I was from, and it was actually NYU Law, Harvard undergraduate, but I turned down Harvard Law because NYU gave me a full scholarship. My dad is still upset that I didn't go to Harvard Law. But anyway, I've been redeeming myself for him ever since. But Julia and I went down to Renz, Georgia. She lived in Renz. It was Renz, Louisville, and Wadley. You got to look for the three because they're so tiny. If you don't look for the three names, you won't find Renz. We went to Sarah Farmington, the matriarch of this family. Our client had murdered her brother in his house with her nephew, and they stole his money belt. It was the nephew's idea. He went to the local military base and said, come on, Billy, I know where we can get $40,000. It's my uncle. He has a $40,000. Let's go get it. And they ended up shooting him. The nephew left for Canada, and Billy was left, and the lawyer told him, look, I play golf with the judge. Just plead guilty. You'll be okay. And he pled guilty, and 10 minutes later, he was sentenced to death. So we had no trial record. We had no facts. We had nothing to argue with. He had a death sentence. That's all we had. We didn't have a record. We didn't have any weapons. And Billy Moore, when I met him, I'll never forget thinking, who is this? And why do I feel funny? I felt funny because I wasn't used to that kind of grace, that awesome grace that emanates from people who believe in Christ. I've only seen it rarely. Very rarely do I feel the spirit of Christ from another human being. I just think that human beings are too flawed, and especially men, because I'm a female chauvinist. And so I just have a very hard time taking any kind of religious anything from men. And I am a female chauvinist. That is my bias. It's not whether you have biases. It's whether you recognize what your biases are and then how you compensate for them. On the IAT test, I don't test for race at all. Take the IAT test. Don't be afraid of finding out that you've got racial biases. Everybody does of some kind. I don't, because I grew up in such a multiracial family, number one. And number two, if you look like me, you can hardly be against any other race because you embody all of them. And number three, I tested off the scales for gender. Oh, my goodness, I have a problem. I have a serious problem. I am quite clear there's a superior gender and that I am a member of it. No. Don't clap, you know. You do not want to abet this, okay? I'm working on it, people. It is my weakness. I love men. Don't get me. I'm not a man. I love men. It's just that I think women are superior. And there's no shaking it. I mean, it just is. So I have to cope with it, and I have to compensate for it. And I have to make sure that I'm bending over backwards to make sure the men in my office are treated fairly. I mean, that's what you just have to compensate for your biases, all right? Ask the men who work for me. It is a strange and wondrous experience, okay? So just understand your biases. But what was I talking about? Billy Neil Moore, Sarah Farmington. Do you know what we did? Julia's Jewish. I'm agnostic at best. Here we are in our overalls and combat boots. They weren't used to us. We were the first girl lawyers who dressed the way we wanted to dress. We didn't wear hose and stockings in the office. We wore those bibbed jeans, overalls with turtlenecks and combat boots. And I did not straighten my hair at the time. So just imagine this hair like this, blowfish. Julia called it the blowfish look. I was scary looking. Plus, I had those thick bottle glasses. I mean, I was a scary looking woman. And I'm much less intense now. So, barely human. We fly down to Wads, Renly, and Louisville, Georgia, find Sarah Farmington's farm out in the backwoods somewhere, arrive on her farm and say, Miss Sarah, we need your help. We've got a free Billy Moore. you have to help us. And she looked at us and she said, I believe God has sent two angels to me. And I need you to pray on this with me, and I need you to stay with me. We stayed with her for 11 days. I didn't know how to clean out an outhouse, but I learned. We helped her do hay in the barn, and we helped her with all her chores, and we helped her clean her kitchen, and we helped her can, and we were singing hymns, and Julia's looking at me, and I said, just move your mouth and sing. And then came the revival, and you know, when they're in revival, every single night they're in church till 11 o'clock at night, and Julia and I are sitting up there in the church with her. And then she wanted us to get baptized, and Julia says, do you think we need to tell her I'm a Jew? I said, no, if she wants us to be baptized, we'll be baptized. I said, just take it in the spirit that it's meant. I said, God loves us. God loves us. I said, you know, God will be fine with us getting baptized. I said, I'm just going to take it the way I need to take it, which is that the water means that I'm now included in some kind of Christian group, and you know, I'm glad to be part of it. I said, and Julia, so are you. And if that's what Ms. Farmer needs, is we're going to do, we got baptized. We got baptized. I was already baptized. You know, my mom had done that. But I was now an adult getting water poured on my thick-ass hair, and Julia is an Ashkenazi Jew. She's got blonde hair and blue eyes, and I'm sitting, and we're sitting up there, all these people laying on our hands, and it actually felt good. It wasn't fake for me. I can take it in the way that an agnostic can take it. I can take the meaning in the way an agnostic can take it. And I can respect the ritual. I can respect the meaning of the ritual. So it wasn't done with total deception. But we never told Ms. Farmer what we really were. Me, an agnostic, and Julia, a Jew. Just the two worst nightmares. And we got baptized. And at the end of it, on the 11th day, she was praying in the morning, and we came and we knelt with her and prayed with her. And she got up and she said, God has moved me. I will help you. We will free Billy Moore. And she did. Sarah Farmer, who just died last month at the age of 87, she freed a man from death row, George's death row. The only man freed from George's death row in the last 20 years was Billy Neil Moore. You should invite him here to speak to you. He's a marvelous speaker. And you will see what I mean by his Christ-like demeanor. Now, Mr. Rook, he went to his death. And I got a note. Maybe 3 weeks after his execution, on the day that he died, I just hung my head in sorrow. I'm probably the only person who wept for him. He was my client, and I understood why he was so evil. And he was evil. And we had made him evil. And I got a note a few days later, and it said, I'm sorry, I called you a trucking yellow runt. You rhyme the words. You are not. You are the only person who tried to help me, and I thank you. A little bit of grace, even from someone like him. I have had an incredible run, ladies and gentlemen, and I base my entire agenda on a Christian prophet, as I said at the beginning of this little rambling talk. And King truly does shape my life. I mean, this isn't for show. I can tell you on every page where he talks about every topic. And every case I've done has stemmed from what he has said has to happen. When I did the MTA case, he said there is no freedom for those without transportation. Transportation is a civil right issue. And so I did the MTA case, and we put $4 billion back into the bus system, and you might see some shelters around. Bottom line is that I have lived a life of enormous privilege, and it has been so much fun. I mean, people like me don't usually have fun in life because we don't know how to. My family is pretty joyless. I mean, if you're a Rice, it means that life is serious business. Yeah, Condoleezza, we're just alike. People don't understand that. They were just alike, and we're not a lot of fun. And the few men who are brave enough to try to date us, they will confirm that we are not a lot of fun. But we do get things done. We get a lot done. And I think that if King were here today, that's a lot of arrogance to talk about what King would want to do, but I'm arrogant enough to do it, and I think I'm quite right. So he would be enormously proud that we've come so far, that we've elected an African-American president and then reelected him. I mean, he would find that wondrous. And he would be right here standing with me asking me why I wasn't doing more. He'd be looking at me like, you're supposed to be a civil rights lawyer. How come your poorest children have gotten poorer over the last 20 years? How come poor rural white kids are the fastest growing poverty group in the country? And why are children from the Bush administration on poorer than they were before the Bush administration? Why did Clinton put more people in prison? Why did Obama deport more mothers and separate more mothers from their infants than any other president? And you gotta understand, I love me some Obama. Even though when I first met him when he was running for Senate and they made the mistake of inviting me to his fundraiser, and I raised my hand because he gave this tired-ass speech, and I raised my hand and I said, why are we supposed to be so impressed with you? I asked the future president of the United States of America why I should be impressed with him, because I didn't see it. I said, you know, I'm here because Maddie Lawson and Michael Lawson invited us, and we think the world of them, and they apparently think the world of you, but I'm trying to figure it out. Why are we supposed to be impressed with you? And he laughed, and he said, you sound like Michelle. And I told him, answer my question. That was my first conversation with him. My second conversation with him came after he became president, and I thought, oh my goodness, I hope he doesn't remember me. But Molly Munger, my law partner, took me to a fundraiser, because of course she gives so much money that she gets invited to the fundraisers, and she has me in tow. And he looks at me and he says, Connie. I said, how come you remember me? He says, how could I forget? And he says, how am I doing? I said, do you really want me to tell you? I said, listen. I said, listen, nobody should separate mothers from their infants. That is profane. It is obscene. And you have separated more mothers from their infants because of this ridiculous immigration. What is the matter with you? I'm talking to the president of the United States now. You know, his guards always move in a little closer whenever I'm talking to him. Because they can see the tone and they can see the president's face freeze up. I told him that his deportation policy was a disgrace and that he needed to stop it and that I wanted to see it change. And that he was not going to get my help unless I saw him change. And there's no reason to deport these people. We bring them here to exploit them and then we're going to what? Separate them from their families? I said, I don't think so. I said, we need to stop this. And you're not getting any credit from the Republicans. I said, if you walked on water, they'd complain you don't swim. I said, what is the matter with you? Why do you give a damn what they think? I said, you stop this immigration crap right now. And we're going to bring these folks in. We're going to make them legal is what we're going to do. He said, got it. He was trying to keep from slapping me is what he was trying to do. Because I was not respectful. Let me put it mildly. I was not amused. You do not take mothers from their infants. That is sacrilege. Motherhood is divine. It is sacred to me. You do not take an infant from his mother. I don't even allow people in my office who have infants to be separate. I tell them, bring the infants in. You don't separate women from their infants. You just don't. And I don't have children for that reason. Because I knew I'd have to bring the baby everywhere I went and I was going to be in dangerous places. I decided not to do it. I married my career, not my children. And plus, there are enough children in the world for me to claim them all. I'm working on behalf of your kids. You know, you raise the kids and I raise hell. That's the division of labor. That's the division of labor I saw. So let me put it this way. I love Obama. When I see him, my heart soars. Don't mistake my cussing him out and calling him on the carpet as anything but love. I adore the guy, and I love his smile. Isn't that a billion-dollar smile? Antonio Villaraigosa has a million-dollar smile, but Obama has a billion-dollar smile. That smile. And he's gutsy. He takes risks. But he's president at a time when it's impossible to get anything done, and I understand that, but he still has to get some stuff done. And he has not been courageous where he can be courageous, and I'm here to criticize him. That's my job. As much as I love you, I'm going to be the pain in your you-know-what. And he knows that, and otherwise he doesn't have to talk to me. He doesn't have to take my, he can act like he doesn't remember me. But he doesn't. He's too smart not to remember me. But anyway, you know, I'm so extraordinarily proud of him, and King's heart would soar like my heart soars whenever I see him and whenever I see Michelle. I'm just thrilled. I am so thrilled. And let me tell you why. It's because of what he symbolizes. He is a very good person, but it's what he symbolizes. And I studied slavery in college at Harvard, and the different systems of slavery throughout the Caribbean and throughout South America and in the United States, the different systems of slavery within the United States, because the Virginia farms where my family came from were very, very small. And you knew your slaves, and you had relationships with yourself, versus the rice plantation in Alabama, which was huge. It was like the Mississippi plantations, which were based on the Haitian model. And in the Haitian model, you worked your slaves to death. You did not anticipate them living. You did not anticipate your slaves surviving, and so you didn't think of them as human beings at all, in any way. You didn't even think of them as animals. So it was a much more brutal system of slavery. You didn't want the French as your colonizers because they left you in the worst shape. Look at Haiti. Portuguese were the second worst, the best were the British. Hate to tell you this, the best were the British. In a system of horrors, the best were the British. So I understand slavery down to the bone. I studied it at Harvard. Fascinating, absolutely fascinating. You need to understand, because that's from where we all come. Our joint heritage is of slavery, together. And I try to point out to people, and this white teacher said, Connie, I know you're angry at us because we don't teach the Civil War. We don't teach. I said, you're handicapping these kids. You're robbing them of their understanding of their civic heritage. That you have to teach slavery. He says, we can't teach slavery because we don't know how to teach it so white kids won't lose their self-esteem. I can't teach slavery because I don't know how to do it without damaging our white children. I appreciated that. I was so happy she told me that because she was telling me her real fears. When people tell you their real fears, they're giving you a gift because they're giving you the key to the solution. Once you understand what's really going on with people, then you can unwind it and you can together forge a solution that addresses their fears. But if they're not honest enough to tell you what they're really... So I said, thank you for telling me that. That took a lot of courage, and you are safe with me. People are racially safe with me. They can tell me their worst fears. The cops know that their worst racial fears are safe with me. I've had cops tell me, Connie, I'm afraid of black people. I don't like black people. Or at least the kind of black people that are in Watts. Once we get down to the truth like that, then we can do business. I need that honesty. So when this teacher told me, I don't know how, I said, let's figure that out. Let's figure out how to teach it so that the white children get as much self-esteem out of this and lose none of their tribal identity or their racial identity. I don't want to damage white children. Why would I want to do that? I don't want to damage any child. So we figured it out. I said, well, you know how I would teach it? I said, let's teach the truth. She said, well, if we teach the truth, they're going to be so damaged. I said, no. If we teach the truth, they're going to come out of here standing 10 feet tall, because you want to know something? You know where you start? You start with the abolition movement. That was our first multiracial freedom movement. I said, my family wouldn't be free without the Quakers. I'd still be a slave if it weren't for John Brown. We'd still be chattel if it weren't for the brave white pastors in the South who stood up and at the risk of the Klan visiting them. I mean, it took a lot of guts to be a white preacher, a white pastor in the South, and stand up and voice support for, even tepid support for the civil rights movement. Your church would be burned down. White people took enormous risks. It took 150 years of abolition movement, and it was white-led. We've got generations of brave white people who helped to free the slaves. We've got Cesar Chavez, who marched with Martin Luther King Jr. We have Japanese Americans who helped us. Abolition was the first multiracial justice movement, and we can celebrate that as our joint heritage. How about starting there? If I were a white kid, I'd be putting medals on my chest. I'd feel so entitled to claim the heritage of abolition righteousness. Look at what Lincoln had to do. We have an incredible, proud heritage. We together, white, black, yellow, brown, freed the slaves. That's how you teach it. One more anecdote, and then I'll answer questions, because actually...
We got to go to church.
Oh, you've got to go? Oh, it's 11? Yeah. Okay, I'm sorry. Is it 5 after 11?
Yeah, it's 5 after 11.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I forgot you had another... Okay, so I'm going to go upstairs and listen to the sermon. Thank you all for listening so much. There is a bookmark with a picture of my book on it. Please buy my book. I have to get it into paperback, or I'm not going to be able to retire. I will be homeless on Skid Row. And it is a great book. Thank you all for having me.
Connie Rice.
Thank you.
Thank you, Connie Rice.